of the liver is enlarged and hypertrophied, and you see that the portal ventral tumor trauma is also healed. This is another case of us that there is a big lesion at the caudate lobe. You see the big lesion at the caudate lobe in CT section. And after a caudate lobe lobectomy, there's an atrophy of the caudate lobe and the total tumoral necrosis. We reached this case to the resection. And this is another case of us. This is very, I want to show this case because of that. That we did the radiation lobectomy and radiation segmentary in one session in one patient. This is the left lobe multiple HCC poking, and this is the segment 6 single lesion. So, doing the tilted angiography, this is segment 5, 8 artery, this is segment 6 artery. Segment 6 artery distally treating the single lesion at the segment 8, segment 6. You see that? And then this is the left hepatic artery, and left hepatic artery feeding multiple HCC poking. And then we super selectively microcatheterized the segment 6 artery. And you see the lesion and the normal parenchyma of segment 6. And this is the super selective left hepatic artery microcatheterization. We see the multiple HCC poking. And it's very important to get a radioembolization with a triangle shape to do all the segments 6 like that. And then after 8 months later, there is an atrophy of the left lobe and complete pathologic complete radiological necrosis, you see. And then, and the, also the necrosis at the segment 6. And then 12 months later, the atrophy continues at the left lobe and the segment 6. We know that the portal vein tumor trauma is a very important issue and a prognostic factor in HCC cases. If you target the portal vein tumor trauma with transfer, according to the MA scintigraphic findings, according to the super selective microcatheterization and detailed angiography, you can also treat the portal vein tumor thrombosis with transfer. This is a study, very important study, coming from France, and they concluded that if you hit the portal vein tumor thrombosis and you see the MA accumulation at the portal vein tumor thrombosis, in this case, the overall survival is very high, and they do another dosimetric study that the high doses of radioembolization also target the portal vein tumor thrombosis, give a very important advantage to portal vein recanalization and downstaging to hepatectomy. Their downstaging ratio in this advanced portal vein tumor thrombosis 12%. This is also a case of us. It's a young lady that very enhancing right lobe HCC, and you see the portal vein total tumor thrombosis enhancing with contrast media. And in angiography, these are the multiple feeding branches of the portal vein tumor thrombosis. It's very important. This angiography is a new angiogenesis. If you hit the this portal vein tumor thrombosis, it means that the successful radioembolization you will have. This is another case of us, very infiltrating right lobe and HCC. This is portal vein, which is enlarged and enhancing in contrast media. This is portal vein tumor thrombosis, and you see, and the portal vein tumor thrombosis uptake a significant FTG. And this is angiography. The stem part of the right hepatic artery, this is microcatheter. You see that this is the left portal-based tumor thrombosis here, feeding with an feeding artery. And this is the right portal vein, enlarged and long. This is the feeding artery. If you give the transfer from here, you can cover the left portal vein tumor thrombosis feeding artery and right portal vein tumor thrombosis feeding artery. Not here, from here. And this, after 26 months later, you see that there is no enhancing infiltrating HCC at the right level of the liver. And the portal vein tumor thrombosis healed with total necrosis with a colossal formation. And in FDG PET, the uptake of the FDG is disappeared. So this is another important portal vein tumor targeting case. This is segment 8 and segment 5, infiltrate nodular HCC. And also there is a portal vein tumor thrombosis, tumor getting access to portal vein through the segment 5. And this is portal vein tumor. If you, if you hit the portal vein tumor thrombosis like that, this is, you see this portal vein, yes, here, and the intraparenchymal branches. If you hit the portal vein like that, the result is like that, radiological necrosis of the portal vein, and the destruction of the segment 5 and 8 with tumor destruction. Immunotherapy combination and the radioembolization, another new concept, a new issue. There are so many clinical trials going on about this issue, this combination of radioembolization and immunotherapy, like combination with Pembro and Nivo and Durvo and Durvo combination. There are some small studies, preliminary studies, that combination with durvalumab, nivolumab, with TARE, there is an ongoing Roman study, TERASPAR study, that the combination of radioembolization with durvalumab immunotherapy agents. So we will see the results and we will see the feature about the combination of immunotherapy and radioembolization. Thank you for your attention.
We can do it. If there is any question answer, we can have a short question and session, and then we proceed for the other presentation.
One question. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. Just to concern, what adverse effects did these patients had post procedure? Because majority of the patients you showed us were elderly, belonging to elderly age group, and some of them had large burden tumors. So any adverse effects that they came across after the procedure, quality of life concerns?
You mean the post-radioembolization follow-up or
yes.
Patient care?
Yes.
Follow-up or patient
follow-up. Yes.
We follow the post-radioembolization cases with the blood chemistry analysis, important the liver enzymes and bilirubin, and the ALB score is very important at the follow-up period. And we never get MR or CT or PET CT images before 2 months ago. After 2 or 3 months later, we can get MRI or PET CT to evaluate the response of radioembolization. In big lesions, especially, we have to give attention to the contrast enhancement part of the lesion. Some residual contrast enhancement part of the lesion we can see, and so that this is the this is an incomplete radioembolization, or wait and see 2 months later, and get do another session of radioembolization, and also follow the patient with tumor markers like AFB, CA999, like that.
So did any patient get sick after the procedure? That's
complicated.
Yes. Some complications can occur. The majority of the complications are mild fatigue, malaise, and the radioembolization is a very well tolerated and low complication rate treatment. The complication rate is below the 4% in most of the cases, and in most of the cases some degree of biliary hazard to the gallbladder, or some non-target deposition of the terrasphere microspheres at the stomach. If you give an attention to angiographic detail, angiographic procedure, and the MA scan, and the non-target embolization, you can prevent non-target embolization. And the most feared complication of radioembolization is radiation-induced liver disease. It's presented with ascites and hyperbilirubinemia. We did so many cases, and we did more than 2,000 cases. Our radiation-induced liver disease ratio is below the 1%. Because of the dosimetric approach and angiographic approach.
Like many of these patients have some sort of shunts also. They have varices. So what are the risk of radiation injury to gastrointestinal tract or to the lungs, for example? And what sort of preparation you perform or workup you perform before doing radioembolization in these cases?
You mean that some cases of ascites in HCC cases?
Arteriopotential. Extrahepatic. Like there may be some liver injury, but there might be some GI injury.
Extrahepatic deposition of the tumor, metastatic disease. Yes. It's ideal that no metastasis when you select the patient for radioembolization.
No, without metastasis.
Without metastasis?
That because we are giving radiation. What sort of workup do you perform before doing the tear? Because there might be some shunts also, there might be some.
Yes. If we see the extrahepatic deposition of MAA in the stomach or gallbladder or duodenum or small intestine, go back to see the examine the angiographic. Detailed angiography, and trying to find the suspicious artery. For example, right hepatic artery is the guilty in most cases in extrahepatic deposition of the stomach. And if we have to give a vial before cystic artery, and cystic artery can deposit the microspheres. In angiography station, we detect these extrahepatic feeding arteries. And even we know that they are the extrahepatic deposition, we give the MAA. And our nuclear medicine physician alert us that this extrahepatic deposition at the stomach and the gallbladder or gallbladder or high lung shunt. So in the treatment session, Y90 session, just before the Y90 injection, we close the suspicious gastric branch or cystic artery branch just before the Y90 injection. If you did the embolization to the guilty feeding artery before 1 week or 2 weeks later in the MA session, you can assure that you will have collateral to the extrahepatic deposition and not embolizable. And the other issue at high lung shunt ratio, maybe Dr. Junaid say something about the lung shunting.
Actually, we are focusing on the lab dose rather than the shunt ratio. If you realize that more than 40-50% lung shunting during the MA scintigraphy, it's obvious that the radioembolization contraindicated in this kind of patient because of the risk of the radiation-related lung toxicity. But generally, when we calculate the dose delivered to the lungs, we realize that even in patient who has more than 20 or 30% lung shunting, we can still have an option to manage the right dose performing the radioembolization. It depends on the, for example, how much dose will deliver to the tumor in the target area and how much dose will be delivered to the lungs during the radioembolization. If you balance these issues, you can treat patients.
If you have shunting, you reduce the dose.
Of course, yes. You have to reduce as much as possible within the effective limits. For example, 10 years ago or 20 years ago, when we started using the cisplatin, if you realize the 20 or 25% lung shunting, we stopped the therapy, so it was a contraindication. But now I realize that we can still manage the most of the patients who has more than the 20 or 25% function effectively.
What is the incidence of radiation pneumonitis in those patients?
Radiation?
Pneumonitis.
Pneumonitis.
Yeah.
Actually, maybe do we have our case? We have only one case.
One case of pneumonitis.
We get more than the 2,000 cases, for example. Actually, we had predicted the lung toxicity, for example, in our case. It's actually depends on the risk and the benefits evaluation. For example, if you treat the patient with advanced stage of ACC, and if you still see the radiation-induced pneumonitis, for example, 2 years or 3 years later on, I think it's not meaningful so much regarding the toxicity, because you can still have an option to improve the overall survival this kind of advanced stage of patients, but you can manage the lung toxicity. So I think it depends on the clinical scenario.
Is there some dose limits that this much has to be given to the lung?
We have dose limits to the lung. For a single treatment, the dose limits, upper limits around the 30 gray, and the cumulatively 50 gray. But it's not so strict limits, actually. For example, you can deliver more than 30 gray, couldn't see any toxicity. But even you deliver the less than the 30 gray, you have to risk to see toxicity, because these thresholds come from the external beam radiation therapy experience. But regarding the radiobiological effect, internal radiation therapy like yttrium nitrate embolization works completely different than the external beam radiotherapy.
Because one thing is this, that if there is a good tumor burden, there are large tumors which are well enhancing, so radiation pneumonitis will have effects later on, but the patient you will lose the patient within a year if you don't treat it.
Yeah, you are right. This is one issue. And also, we have an option in details. For example, in this kind of patient, we prefer deliver the lower amount of the spheres with high specific
downstaging.
Yeah, for downstaging and also lower treatment. For example, if the patient has higher level of lung shunting, because when you deliver the lower amount of the spheres to the lungs, for example, the hazard will be less and limited, rather than the delivering to more spheres with lower specificity. So we have options to manage it.
One question. You showed many cases with portal vein tumor thrombosis, and they showed a very good result with the radioembolization. And that's a major issue with the other treatment which we are doing, chemoembolization, like TACE. TACE usually do not have good effect on the portal vein tumor thrombosis or the vascular invasion. But you showed very good results with these with the radioembolization in these cases. So what's your experience regarding the vascular portal vein tumor thrombus?
Big tear.
Yeah.
We had so many cases with portal vein tumor thrombosis. The most important thing in portal vein tumor thrombosis cases is to hit the portal vein tumor thrombosis. In angiographic study, doing angiographic study, one should see the feeding artery of portal vein tumor thrombosis. Sometimes you can't see the definite feeding artery to portal vein tumor thrombosis. This means that's very tiny, very small branches going to portal vein tumor thrombosis. So you can't microcatheterize them. The most important thing that put the microcatheter, the middle or proximal part of the right hepatic artery or left hepatic artery to cover or to see the portal vein tumor thrombosis and do an angiogram, but it's important, very important that angiogram do a common CT. If you see the portal vein tumor thrombosis enhancing, and you show that your microcatheter tip before the feeding branches of the portal vein tumor thrombosis, and you verify it with common CT, so you can cover portal vein tumor thrombosis. You inject the vial, and you sure that some part of the microspheres will go to the portal vein tumor thrombosis, and the responses will be very dramatic, as you see, very dramatic.
Are you doing dosimetry in one compartment model or multi compartment model?
Actually, it depends on your intent. For example, if you aim to radiation segmentectomy, you can perform a single compartment model dosimetry because there is no need to differentiate the tumor and the normal liver parenchyma in the targeted volume. The aim of the radiation segmentectomy necrotizes the targeted volume, including the tumor. So the single compartment model works very well in this situation. But for example, if you want to treat multiple lesions located in the one lobe by using lobar approach, we need the personalized multi-compartment dosimetric methodology. So it's a little bit different concept. Okay. Since we have a limited time, we couldn't talk about some details, especially regarding the dosimetric planning, but we can discuss during the day.
Murad, I would like to ask you, the benefit, such a good presentation, and so number of cases, with less number of morbidities and higher success rate, are you still being used tear as a downstaging protocol in your country?
Downstaging protocol.
Most of the patients are suffering from their CAD, and after the complete radiological response, one should go for a liver transplantation. Are you still being followed that criteria?
Actually, we don't have so much strict criteria or guidance for managing this kind of patients, but as you know that there is a new evidence coming from especially Milano group and also, as I remember, memorials from Katayin group. They published that if you downstage the patients, even in extra Milani criteria in the diagnosis time, you can still have an option to increase the overall survival after transplantation. So I think the downstaging issue will get much more popular, and then I think we will use radioembolization for downstaging purposes much more in, if you compare the previous one. So we need these kind of actually protocols maybe, but we don't have yet. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Because it seems like it's completely vanished from radiologically vanished tumor from the whole of the lobe as well as the portal vein.
Mm-hmm.
And what's the reason?
I think that in many cases which you showed, they were child class A.
Right.
Yeah, so those cases in which this is child class B or something in which the patient is needing liver transplantation.
Yeah, there are many issues which we have to
But if the patient has preserved, good preserved function and he is doing well, so...
How many patients, you have done more than 2,000 patients at your center, how many patients underwent liver transplant later on?
Yeah, it's a good question.
Yeah.
Not so much, actually.
Yeah, not so much.
Maybe...
Not more than 10%,
right? Yeah, yeah, maybe 10% only.
Because most of our cases were advanced cases, very advanced cases.
And there are also many flu issues. For example, what is the time interval between the downstaging and the decision of the transplantation for safely predicting the outcome of the patients? We don't know yet.
We don't know yet. There's no confirmation.
For example, if there's any surgeon who would like to make comments, please.
He is himself a surgeon.
He is a surgeon.
For example, if we downstage this kind of advanced stage of patient with portal thrombosis, when you think about the transplant, this kind
the time
of patients, the time of the transplantation. More than 6 months, 1 year?
Ideally, it would be between six months to one year.
Six
months.
At
least for a portal.
At least, for example.
It's my suggestion, it's not a guideline, actually. It has to be worked on these guidelines as well. And because these are the tumors, those are the patients who are, we have nothing to give them. We are nothing offering them, actually. And you showed a very good data with a complete resolution, complete radiological resolution of these type of tumor, then they should have a chance in future. But the time has to be decided by, although I don't know if RCTs can be carried out on these things or not, but a good retrospective data can.
I think Dr. Jayadeh, do transplant? You have some criteria with child class that if the patient is C, we are going to do the transplant or?
Any patient with SCLD, with SCC, is a transplantation. There is no if and but in this kind of.
It is possible.
Yes. I think we have if it's within the Milan criteria, the patient is vicious, any patient with CLD. Documented clearly whether it is a child criteria A, B, or C. And within the Milan criteria or extended like UCS criteria, liver transplantation is a definitive option for a tumor. Rest are all.
I think we can have another talk and then we'll have more discussion. Right?
Okay.
Thank you for that.
Thank you, Doctor, for sharing your expertise. Now we delve into the application of TARE in liver metastasis and intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. This presentation will be delivered by Dr. Turkman.
Now, during my second presentation, I would like to briefly talk about the role of radioembolization in metastatic liver disease. Actually, this survey was conducted by CIRSE a couple of years ago to aim to gather information about daily practice of the radioembolization in European countries. And as you've seen in the results, frequency of the radioembolization in metastatic disease, colorectal carcinoma metastasis, neuroendocrine tumors, and breast cancer metastasis, and others. Actually, it was compatible with our experience. The colorectal cancer metastasis most frequent indication in radioembolization in metastatic disease. Because you know that the liver is the most common site of the metastasis from colorectal cancer, but unfortunately 8% of the patients with CRC metastasis are ineligible for resection in the time of the diagnosis. And local regional approaches, including radioembolization, for liver-confined metastasis may offer clinically meaningful benefit beyond that the systemic therapy alone. But unfortunately, Foxfire, Sirflox, and Foxfire global studies performed by using the CIRS pairs reported no difference in the overall survival or progression-free survival with the addition of radioembolization to standard chemotherapy in first line. And the salvage settings therapy is the most common indication of the radioembolization, and there are many publications in the literature. And when we look at the results, median overall survival about 10 months between the 8 to 13 months in different studies. But also, these studies show us radioembolization is safe in an acceptable toxicity profile, even in heavily pretreated patient population in chemotherapy after three or third line or other experimental therapy settings. And also, ECO and hemotoxicity could be problem for the patient selection. Sometimes it's difficult to add radioembolization in this kind of patient has toxicity, depends on the systemic therapy. And we know that when we use the radioembolization in salvage settings, it will be palliative intent always. And the recent study, EPOCH study, which has aimed to investigate the safety and efficacy of adding U290 glass radioembolization to standard of care second-line chemotherapy in patients with CRC liver metastasis who had progressed on first-line treatment. It was the first. Sorry, can you understand?
Can
you see my presentation?
Yeah, we can see your presentation. So it's on Zoom, so someone has.
Oh, okay. This. Okay. When we look at the study design, study design of the EPOCH study, when we look at the key eligibility criteria, unresectable, unilobar or bilobar colorectal metastasis, able to receive second-line or oxaliplatin-based chemotherapy, and measurable disease by RECIST criteria, and also good liver and kidney function. And during the stratification, there was a unilobar, bilobar disease, KRAS status, irinotecan or oxaliplatin-based first-line chemotherapy. Then patient randomized in almost 28 patients randomized in 95 sites in all over the world, including US, Europe, and Asia, actually. And in the therapy arm, there was 215 patients, which treated by radioembolization plus chemotherapy. And the second arm, there was 213 patients treated only chemotherapy and then follow-up. Here you can see the exclusion criteria. Actually, limited extrahepatic disease permitted in this trial. It means that less than 5 indeterminate lung lesions, less than 1 centimeter, and lymph nodes less than 1.5 centimeter permitted the study as a limited extrahepatic disease. And, here you can see that the well-balanced patient and disease characteristics between treatment and control arms in advanced stage of disease. Also interesting findings that almost over 30% of the patients had primary in situ in both arms, not operated. And if you look at the primary endpoint of the study, progression-free survival, patients receiving radioembolization plus chemotherapy were 31% less likely to show disease progression or death versus chemotherapy arm. So it's very meaningful and hazard ratio about 0.69, and median overall survival about 8 months in radioembolization plus chemo arm and 7.2 months in chemotherapy arm. And another primary endpoint, hepatic progression-free survival, it was also meaningful. It's about 9 points. Survival also meaningful. It's about 9.1 months in the radioembolization plus chemo arm and 7.2 months. And it was a positive outcome. And the secondary endpoint, overall survival, unfortunately, there was no significant difference were found in overall survival. But I have to mention that this study not designed and powered for aiming the endpoint of the overall survival, because there was a hierarchical design. If the patient don't meet the primary endpoints, it's not possible to move on the secondary endpoints. And as you see here, there was a cross change in the both arms, more than the 50% of the patients. And regarding the adverse events, there's a numerical difference if you look at the two arms. Actually, it's expected that when you add the radiation-related therapy to the chemotherapy, you can increase some amount of the adverse events. But if you look at the statistical analysis, there was no difference, actually. Most common adverse events was neutropenia. It's increased over twofold higher in radioembolization. And key characteristics of the interest associated with progression-free survival benefit with radioembolization plus chemo include tumors with KRAS mutation, hepatic tumor burden, and number of the lesions, left-sided primary tumor and addition of a biologic agent. Actually, if you remember that the result of the cephalox study, it seems like the performing the radioembolization plus chemotherapy seems like more meaningful in patient who has right-sided tumor. But in this study, it's contrast actually, but it depends on the patient selection criteria, I think, because this study conducted in the second line, so it's different. And actually, additionally, these results, we can still use the radioembolization in colorectal cancer metastasis for super selectively targeted treatments, as seen on this case, for example, like in HCC, and also for downstaging purposes. Here you can see the patient with multiple metastatic lesions presented during the diagnosis in the right lobe. And after the first line chemotherapy, there was a response, and only this tumor, almost around 10 centimeter diameter, located in the right lobe. Here you can see the increased metabolic activity in IFTG-PET study. And after performing the radioembolization to the right lobe, here you can see very nice metabolic response. And in the follow-up, up to 1 year, here you can see that according to RECIST criteria, the tumor size reduced and also getting necrosized after 1 year. Then our surgeons tried decision performing the right hepatectomy after one year. As we discussed earlier, actually, this approach also give us biological test of time of the disease, even in patients in multiple metastatic lesions. And another indication is neuroendocrine tumor, and it is maybe the most meaningful overall survival can get in the neuroendocrine tumor because of the good prognosis of the disease. And when we look at the literature, and if we combine with the partial response, complete response, and the stable disease, most of the patients get benefit from radioembolization. You know that if the neuroendocrine tumor patients has liver metastasis, we have many options, starting from the just follow-up and add the somatostatin analogs and also systemic therapies, including radiopeptide therapies. Here an example from our series, primary unknown neuroendocrine tumor metastasis in the liver. Actually, if you look at the metastatic tumor volume, it's very extensive. This is only an exception regarding the radioembolization indication. Generally, for example, if this kind of patients in colorectal metastasis, we don't want to treat with high amount of tumor volume in this situation because of the toxicity risk of the patients. But in neuroendocrine tumors, since most of them has very hypervascular lesions, we can easily treat this kind of patients and preventing the radiation-induced liver toxicity. Here you can see that 3 months later on, this was the FTG-PET study, and also metabolic response very prominent in the 12 lobe after radioembolization. And another example with a young man with gastric neuroendocrine tumor, grade 2, T67 around 18. Here you can see also many metastatic nodular lesions located both lobe of the liver. Here you can see the primary located in the stomach and also omental metastasis. And also in neuroendocrine tumor patients, the extrahepatic metastatic ratio could be much higher if you compare the other primary tumors. Because we know that because of the good prognosis, adding the local therapy, including the radioembolization for the liver metastasis, will be still meaningful for improving the overall survival in this kind of patients. This is the gallium-68 daughter Tate study, and here you can see that the angiography, very hypervascular tumor located in the right lobe. We have many options, including radiopeptide therapy. For example, nuclear medicine physicians generally prefer to start with the lutetium dotatate radiopeptide therapy in this kind of patients, because we have many evidence, including the NETTER study results. But in this situation, if the patient, for example, grade 2 or higher pathological level of the neuroendocrine tumor, we prefer to start with the radioembolization, quick control of the liver metastasis. Then we continue the radioembolization to the right lobe. Here you can see the yttrium-90 distribution after the therapy. And it's obvious that the tumorous cell doses very higher, but the normal liver parenchyma affected much less regarding the radiation effect. And here you can see that this is the peer treatment gallium-68 PET-CT. Here you can see the metastatic lesions. This is the yttrium-90 imaging. And just 1 month later on, here you can see the almost complete metabolic response in the right lobe. So it's obvious that you can quickly control the disease by using radioembolization. For example, in radiopeptide therapy, if you think that we can give the cures between the 6 to 8 weeks interval, we need more time controlling the disease. Then we move on to continue with radiopeptide therapy in this patient. And this study actually coming from the 6 tertiary centers in Europe and United States, enrolling the almost 200 patients, and then follow up after the treatment by using radiopeptide and radioembolization. The main results are that second line radioembolization is associated with increasing overall survival and significant increase in progression-free survival. Overall survival slightly superior to that seen in published receptor radioembolization therapy data, but it was very heterogeneous, as you expected. And the vascularization type of hepatic metastasis does not significantly affect survival after yttrium-90. It's actually controversial, but the result of this study. And the presence of extrahepatic metastatic disease in this kind of patient does not significantly affect overall survival. So it's meaningful to perform radioembolization in patients with neuroendocrine tumor and also extrahepatic liver metastasis. And lastly, the breast cancer. Actually, when we look at the literature, there are many published studies, both glass and resin spheres, radioembolization, but very heterogeneous patient groups. So it's not possible to make conclusion. And we know that we have many systemic therapy options in breast cancer, liver metastatic patients. So generally, look at the results. In the salvage settings, the tumor response rates over the 80%, and also overall survival around to 8 to 20 months after the therapy. So generally, we prefer discuss with our oncologists if there is an option for the systemic therapy in breast cancer, liver metastasis. We prefer continue with the systemic one, but sometimes we add the radioembolization for the treatment of this kind of patients. Here is an example of, generally, these are advanced stage of disease and generally bilobar metastatic lesions, and the radioembolization intent will be palliative settings. But also, as we discussed in the primary liver cancer and colorectal cancer, it's possible to treat super selectively if the patient, for example, only one or several lesions, meaning this stable in the follow-up period. Here you can see super selectively treated lesions just for 2 months later on. Here you can see completely necrotized after radioembolization. So as a completion, the addition of radioembolization to second-line systemic therapy for colorectal cancer metastasis resulted in significantly longer progression-free survival and hepatic-free progression-free survival. There is no evidence regarding the improved overall survival, but it's not issue only for radioembolization. I think the addition of the locoregional treatment in colorectal liver metastasis still controversial issue if you look at the literature. But in advanced stage of colorectal cancer metastasis and breast cancer, if exhaustion of the patient or failure of the chemotherapy, radioembolization will be still an option. And pre-surgery, induction of future liver remnant hypertrophy is another indication for radioembolization. And neuroendocrine tumors, we can enlarge our indication, including the extrahepatic liver metastasis patients, and we can use radioembolization safely. And it's obvious that the well-designed prospective and randomized studies are needed to better understand the role of timing of radioembolization in the metastatic treatment algorithm. Thank you so much. If you have any questions.
Yes. In your, I think, first or second slide, you mentioned about the tear, but the tear that was used for the search spheres, not the thera sphere, and now your studies are on the thera sphere. Is there any difference between thera sphere and search sphere for colorectal cancer metastasis, as far as the efficacy is concerned?
Actually, if you look at the search spheres, in CIRPOLS or global CIRPOLS studies, there was a difference in the dosimetric approach. You know that the CIRPOLS in the beginning recommend to use BSA-based methodology. But today we know that the BSA-based methodology doesn't work both in the metastatic and primary liver cancer treatment by using radioembolization. Now they have changed their approach as seen on the therasphere dosimetric approach, and personalized approach getting much more popular. Because it's not possible to predict just looking at the patient body surface area. This is the radiation related therapy. We have to focus to tumoricidal dose and also normal liver parenchymal dose for safely increase our therapeutic doses. So I can say that yes, there is an obvious difference between the two products regarding the specific activity and the number of the spheres. But you can still have an option to manage the radioembolization using both products, but you don't use the standard methodology for dosimetric calculation. If you, for example, if you look at the surveillance studies or the other studies conducted with the CIR spheres in the ACC and the retrospective analysis, you can see that when using the BSA methodology, it's not possible to increase the effectiveness of the therapy. It's same in the metastatic disease, actually. We have many good cases managed by the therasphere.
Is this the approved sort of therapy for metastatic colorectal cancer?
In United States, actually, therasphere not still approved by the FDA, but it's commonly used. Since they are registered by the medical device, not a radiopharmaceutic or drug, there's a difference between the FDA approved issues. For example, in the ACC, because of the legacy study, therasphere getting the FDA approved in the ACC, but there is no FDA approval in the CIRSPHERE. So this is different situation from the drug registration. Okay, thank you so much.
that perspicacious discussion.
I think that a brief presentation. Yeah.
If you have time.
If you have time. Excuse me. Excuse me for interruption. I want to give a very brief presentation about the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. I think that intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma is important as hepatocellular carcinoma because of generally intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma do not respond to chemotherapy well, and adding transarterial radioembolization in combination with systemic therapy may be an extra benefit to the patients. Yes, this is Duke University protocol for the treatment of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, and it's the same as ESMO or ASCO protocol. They divided the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma in three stages. One is the local and the other is regional, the other is systemic. In the local, there is solitary tumor, technically resectable. Before the resection or after resection, maybe some kind of a local treatment like embolization, radiation, and ablation can do. And in regional stage, of course, the role of systemic therapy is very important as a cytotoxic chemotherapy plus immunotherapy like standard of care, gemcitabine and cisplatin plus durvalumab, and the targeted therapy. And we can add radioembolization or hepatic arterial infusion in any stage of this this stage, and in systemic stage, of course, liver and distant metastasis disease. Systemic treatment or clinical trials may benefit the patient. This is the ESMO clinical guidelines for intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, that you see that the local therapy has a place in the early and local advanced stage. These are the clinical outcome of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. Until 2015, you see that the response rate is very variable because this disease is very variable according to the nodular pattern or infiltrative pattern or some degree of metastasis, but we know that the disease control rate with radioembolization is high, and these are the recent studies after 2018. The median overall survival is between 12 months and 29 months. This is an important study that coming from the French group. They combine the radioembolization treatment with standard of care systemic treatment, cisplatin gemcitabine, together in the first line treatment of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. They concluded that the progression free survival in the combination arm is 16 months, and the chemotherapy alone arm is 11 months. And I think it's important to bridge the or downstage the cholangiocarcinoma to resection. They bridging the 11 cases to resection. This is a very high proportion, and overall survival above 70 months. So this is a recent study coming from the same group from France. The study name is MISPEC trial. They combine the transarterial radioembolization and GISCAM chemotherapy in the first line settings of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma treatment. So the response rate, disease rate according to RECIST is about 30%, and disease control rate is very high, about 90%, and median overall survival 22 months, and the median progression free survival 14 months. It is important that 20% of the cases downstaging to R0 resection in this study. So the phase 3 study is in progress. So as a summary, when we look at the picture of the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, the survival without treatment is very low, approximately 1 year. And the resectability at the diagnosis is around 20%. And the post-operative 5 years survival is variable from patient to patient, but it between the 5 to 40%. In gemcitabine cisplatin systemic treatment, the overall survival is 11 months, progression-free survival 8 months, and disease control rate 81%. With Y90, just a similar findings with systemic chemotherapy, but when we combine the systemic chemotherapy with radioembolization, the overall survival, progression-free survival, and disease control rate will high, and most important, there is a resectability downstage into resection is the main issue in cholangiocarcinoma. This is our one of our intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma cases. It's a typical like huge lesion, centrally located to the liver, located many segments. The segment 3, segment 1, segment 5, segment 8, segment 7, and this is the MR, and then the PET CT images, and the CA99 is above 300, and 6 months later, we get a significant amount of necrosis in the lesion, and 15 months later, the lesion shrinkage totally necrotized. So this is a multinodular intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma case of us. We did the super selective radioembolization, and we get a super selective total necrosis, sparing the normal parenchyma. This is our another case of cholangiocarcinoma, a big central located cholangiocarcinoma, very significant FTG uptake. And after radioembolization, 3 months later and 4 months later, the tumor responds very well to the radioembolization treatment, with anatomically and metabolically also. And our surgeon resected right lobe with resection of the tumor, and this is post-op pathological specimen. These are the glass microsphere, you see, and the pathologic necrosis is above 90%. And when we follow up this case, there is no recurrent lesion at the left lobe of the liver, right lobe resected, and she's also living nowadays, the last follow-up 2021. This is another case of us. It's a young man, nodular, multiple nodular cholangiocarcinoma throughout the right lobe of the liver. You see the many lesions at the right lobe, and ascites also, and also pleural effusion. It's a very advanced case, but the case is 39 years old, very young man. So we accept the risk of the patient, and then we did the radioembolization after 3 months later, that according to the PET CT, there is almost near total metabolic response. The FDG uptake of the lesions are disappeared, as you see. This is another case of us, also the young man, the cholangiocarcinoma located at the caudate lobe. We know that the caudate lobe is a problematic lobe, problematic segment. It's very difficult to treat with the radioembolization. The caudate lobe vascularization is different from patient to patient. It's carrying many feeding arteries from the right or left hepatic artery. And then we treat this case with radioembolization. And this is very important, not only treat the lesion area, and treat also the some degree of normal parenchyma around the lesion. And this is the complete radiological necrosis, as you see. And this is these are the coronal section. This is the pre-treatment lesion. And after radioembolization, the complete radiological necrosis. And this is the pre-treatment PET CT imaging, uptake of FDG, and after treatment, there is no uptake of FDG. This is a case of radiation lobectomy or segmentectomy of caudate lobe cholangiocarcinoma. It's getting a complete pathologic necrosis. He's doing well and he's still alive. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir, for such an incredible presentation. Now, I would like to call upon Professor Mohammed Ali, an accomplished interventional radiologist at Dr. Ziauddin Hospital, Karachi, for demonstration of pre-treatment planning and case discussion. Dr. Ali is a distinguished vascular interventional radiologist whose passion lies in neurovascular, peripheral vascular, hepatobiliary, and oncologic interventions. With a keen eye for innovation, Dr. Ali is not only expert practitioner, but also an active researcher, boosting approximately 40 publications in esteemed journals. As the current finance secretary of Interventional Radiology Society of Pakistan, Dr. Ali demonstrates leadership and dedication to advancing the field. With his blend of clinical expertise and research acumen, Dr. Ali is committed to providing exceptional patient care and driving progress in interventional radiology. Sir, please. Thank you.
patient. First of all, I welcome Dr. Junaid and Dr. Murad here in Pakistan, Karachi. And they are very overnight flight, must be tired, but they give, given a very dedicated talk. And I'm very thankful to our prestigious audience comprising our newer surgeons, oncologists, gastroenterologists, ear intervention radiologists, and our nuclear medicine team. So I just give a brief how we start planning for the Y90 radioembolization. Dr. Akhtar is and Dr. Sajid is here. So first of all, they made effort to get the licensing from the Pakistan Nuclear Regulatory Authority. So this was the first step. We just completed the first step and then we start taking patients and then we do the workup like ultrasound, CT and MRI for the patient, complete labs, PET CT for every patient. And then we have our HPV and GI tumor board. We have recently started this tumor board considering the availability of Dr. Zagam, our head of the tumor transplant team. And then we have a first consultation for thyrosphere with Dr. Junaid. And then we discuss our cases. And once he initially agreed for the case, then we proceed for the mapping angiography with TSA, which Dr. Murad has shown in our presentation. And then we do the selective cone beam CT. Actually, we don't have the cone beam CT available at the cath lab, so we put the catheter inside and then we shift the patient to the CT scan department and take the CT scan, selectively targeting the tumor vessels. And in the same setting after the CT scan, our nuclear team injected the microaggregated albumin for the lung perfusion scan. And so in that case, in this makeshift arrangement, we completed our mapping angiography and selective CT scan as well as the microaggregated albumin. One more thing, if you want to start the facility at your center, you have to arrange the microaggregated albumin as well, which we purchased in the mean course of the time. So the combined effort from the radiology and nuclear medicine and our whole team comprising our HPV team. Then we have a second consultation for thyrosphere, and this time it was a detailed consultation with Dr. Murad and Dr. Junaid. And all these things were, all these consultations were during the Ramadan timings. So we were just trying to keep up with the pace and to not delay the procedures. And then we have a dose calculations based on these measurements of the lung perfusion scan, mapping CT, angiography, cone beam CT. And then we order the dose. And then we have planned the procedure. We plan to do a SPECT CT afterwards. The patient is now in the cath lab, they are preparing it. So we do the procedure, do the SPECT, and then we have 24-hour PET CT. This is our plan. So the combined team effort, as I mentioned, the radiology, the nuclear medicine, liver surgery, gastroenterology, oncology, and definitely hospital management. The whole management gave us the wholehearted support for this treatment facility. And I think one more thing I did not mention, the Boston Scientific and Frozen's, they work really hard to get these things for that procedure. So just showing our license, we just got this license first, then we started our HPV and GI MBT and discussed each and every case thoroughly before proceeding for the consultation with our Turkish colleagues. Just briefly discussing our case. One is a 50-year-old gentleman with child A, ECOG 0, initially presented with upper abdominal pain, is a multicentric right lobe HCC. One session of case in November 2023, but current study shows interval development of new multicentric HCC in the right lobe. PET CT shows multifocal lesions and the overall tumor collectively measures around 13 centimeters. A few small lymph nodes are also there, one of them showing SUV of 5.1, but this lymph node is fortunately supplied by our selective tumor vessel, so hopefully it will be covered with the radioembolization. No other distant diseases. So if the child is core young patient, we will perform it at the first case today, and performance fit is very good. The MELT stand, BCLC, CI kept is seen because of focal solitary lymph node involvement. AFP levels is 6.8, but TIFCA is significantly high. and the bilirubin and all other things, albumin, all the things are okay. So just showing the CT scan, you can see this is a tumor here in the right lobe, another tumor here in the left lobe segment 4, and we plan to microwave ablate this region and do ablation for the right lobe region. The large, you can see the previous disc, lateral deposition here, another deposition here. This is a lymph node, small lymph nodes, lymph node here, and this is supplied by the hepatic vessel. You can see there is almost 13 cm tumor here. Another tumor here in the segment 8, but appears it will also be covered. So we did the PET CT scan, you can see here is a tumor, faint activity in the lymph node as well. But this lesion was not very heavy. So we do the mapping angiography. We first cannulate the left hepatic artery and see the supply of the segment 4 tumor which we want to microwave ablate. And then we did the multiple angiographies of the right hepatic artery. You can see here this is a cystic artery coming from, here, right hepatic from here. And there are multiple branches which are supplying the tumor. You can see we also do the selective runs, but thought that these runs are not completely covering the tumor. So we kept this is what we planned. Dr. Murad mentioned we keep catheter somewhat here.
Yes, sure.
Yeah, this is the place.
But so passing the cystic artery.
Yeah. So we plan to pass the cystic artery and put the catheter here and cover this small region as well as that multicentric ICC. And this is the position we planned for the radioembolization. So these are the mapping CT angiography which we do by shifting. You can see the catheter here in the hepatic artery, and we do the mapping CT again showing this is a catheter and the cystic artery, and this is covering the entire regions. So this was the lung shunt scan was performed by our nuclear team, and you can see there's a avid activity by the tumor, but lung fraction is less than 10%, which is the ideal for radioembolization. So our plan is a tear for the right lobe regions and microwave ablation for the left lobe region and systemic treatment for early node involvement if required. We hope it will be covered with the tear, but if there is requirement, we can give systemic therapy. And this is the dose calculated by our Dr. Junaid, and you can see here 17.5 GBQ, and this is the dose we have which is calculated and will be given to the patient. Our second case is a 62-year-old gentleman, again child A, ECOG 0. He is a very healthy, active person. A large multicentric HCC with the tumor thrombus in the anterior septal branch of the right portal vein. And you can see the PET CT shows hypermetabolic mass measuring around 12.9 centimeter. This patient has only focal thrombus in the portal vein, but there is no nodal, adrenal, pulmonary or bony metastasis. No vascular, there is a vascular major. And then this is, again, a child score 8, ECOG 0, MELD 8, BCLCC due to right anterior branch portal vein invasion. And these are the levels you can see. AP is significantly elevated. PIFCA 2 is 22,000. The bilirubin is okay, albumin is also fine, creatinine is also fine, the other parameters are within normal limits. You can see here is a large region, and the PET CT you can see. So we do, for the mapping angio, before doing the mapping angio, we carefully read the CT scan, maybe images, and see how it will work on the mapping DS. You can see there are three vessels here. So we point out every vessel and tumor thrombus on CT scan, CT angiography. This is the tumor thrombus. And then make an idea before doing the mapping angio, and make an idea on the CT angiography and see each and every vessel. And then you can see here, this is the catheter within the main hepatic artery, and this is the left hepatic artery. And then there are three branches. This is the first branch, and this is the second segment 8 branch. The first branch is segment 7 branch. The main trunk is segment 8 branch. And then there is a combined trunk of segment 5 and 6. So we cannulate the segment, left hepatic artery. You can see the right testicle rising from here, and there is no tumors supply from the left side. And then the, we cannulate the segment 7 branch, there is small stain supply to the tumor from it. And then this is the main branch, which is a segment 8 branch, which is supplying the majority of the tumor here. And this is a segment, combined trunk of the segment 5 and 6. And you can see the major supply is from the segment 5 branch. We also check the other vessel because the tumor was extending up to the subdiaphragmatic location. So we check the phrenic artery as well. So we initially thought to do the mapping angio from the main trunk, the catheter position here, and see the mapping angio, and you can compare it, our mapping angiography, compare to the PET CT scan. So everything is covered, and then we perform the lung shunt scan with the overall lung shunt fraction of 8.8%. But one thing is not included in this presentation, which Dr. Junaid and Dr. Murad recommended, not to inject from the main right hepatic artery, but they recommend to do dual injections from segment 8 and 6 branches. So what we plan in this case is to inject one dose from this segment 5 and 6 branch and the other dose from the segment 8 branch. So this patient, because in the MAA scan, the lung perfusion scan, scintigraphy, the tumor dose is not homogeneous because the patient has cyst in the segment 8 lesion and more dose was going towards the segment 5 and 6. So we divided the doses in two injections and the two vials, one in segment 8 and other in the segment 5. So both trained the single setting and separate doses. And this is the dose plan you can see here for this patient. So first dose was given in the segment 8 with 7 GBQ and the other dose is 6 GBQ. Thank you. So I think any questions, any further questions or remarks about that? I think we conclude this session here. And then we will move to the cath lab, and Dr. Junaid will demonstrate the how to prepare the kit and all these things. I think we will have limited person availability here inside, but we have a common room before. We will all see that how we made the kit and all the things. So can we have some pictures here?
Definitely.
Take pictures and then we will see
for the cath lab.
I think Bahar mein aate hain.
Okay, nice to meet you.
Dr. Sahid, one of the
gastroenterologists,
my boss.
He's my teacher.
Very nice to meet you.
Doctor, is a very successful intervention with religious and dedicated. The presentation is very well, informative, didactic. Yeah,
congratulations.